Blogtalk Radio.
Welcome to the Holistic Healing Using Energy Modalities, specifically the Yuen Method, EFT, and Reiki talk show. Also, we talk about the Law of Attraction. I am your host, John Fletcher, and I can be reached at http://peakpotentialpros.com. That's www.peakpotentialpros.com. Also by email, which is peak.performance.profs@gmail.com, peak.performance.profs@gmail.com. In this show, we make every endeavor to interview some of the masters of different healing modalities, including emotional freedom technique, the Yuen method, and neuro-linguistic programming, and provide a resource for people that want to learn about those healing modalities as well as the Law of Attraction. Again, I'm your host, John Fletcher, and thank you for listening to the Holistic Healing Show using energy modalities, the Yuen Method, EFT, and NLP talk show.
Thank you for listening. Again, if you're listening to this on as a download or on my YouTube channel, the phone number to call in for future reference for Thursdays at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time is area code 347-838-9279, area code 347-838-9279. Again, I'm your host, John Fletcher, and I can be also reached at www.peakpotentialpros.com. That is www.peakpotentialpros.com, where we show you, your family, your group, as well as your company, how they can reach their peak potential individually or collectively. We have some very cutting-edge techniques that help you to move faster, further, with less effort to reach your goals. What are we going to talk about today? What if? Again, what if is one of the things we're going to talk about. What if you had a healing technique that is literally at your fingertips that can allow you to remove any resistance from any area of your life so you could actually be more successful in that area? Because not only does healing have a two-sided coin, but basically anything that you want to do, anything that you want to manifest actually has a two-sided coin. One side is releasing or letting go or changing or disabling the negative impact of something that is actually holding you back. So it's sort of like, you know, that person who is trying to drive as fast as possible, but they have bugs on their windshield, as well as they have one of their feet on the brakes, or maybe the handbrake up or something. The handbrake is actually slowing them down, but the bugs on the windshield, what is that and what could that be? One description of the bugs on the windshield is different experiences that have actually clouded your judgment, whether those experiences are good. For example, those stories about people who joined some type of organization or some type of a group, or maybe had some type of a change in their life that seemed like it was almost like an overnight success, where they just, almost like magically created something. Not saying that is not true for you or true for me. It's just that sometimes those you know, those fast results gives people a unbelievable expectation that the person who achieved those phenomenal results only did it overnight. The truth is that if someone actually had rapid results like that, they were aligned in their mind, their body, and their spirit with zero or maybe just only a tiny bit of resistance that allowed them to actually manifest that result in that area of their life so fast. That area of their life could be mental, physical, emotional, spiritual, psychological, psychic, / empathetic. It could be something social. It could be something as far as, you know, being elected to something or joining some type of or being accepted into some type of group. Let's say, like, if you are a lawyer or, you know, passing the bar or whatever, it could be something that is financial. You know, someone joining a multi-level marketing organization and seemingly, you know, within a almost unbelievable short period of time, they quickly rose to the top of that organization and became very wealthy in the process and had some type of residual income. I'm not saying that that result is something that you cannot do. I am suggesting that sometimes those idealistic expectations can be sort of like a bug on the windshield that that actually gets in your way and doesn't focus your efforts on doing the work that it actually takes to get there. Another, but the main type of bug on the windshield, the one that most of us resonate with a lot more, are the negative experiences that we've actually picked up on along our path, along this you know, journey that we're driving, trying to go as fast as possible to get from A to Z, Z being a place that we really want to be in. A lot of times we have had negative experiences along the way. People who have actually hurt or helped shape our self-esteem in some way that's not really productive for us, so that we don't actually see or express our potential in one way, shape, or form. Some type of a painful experience, maybe. You know, maybe it's a child that wants to play a particular sport, but maybe they're the wrong gender. It's like a girl wanting to play, you know, professional football or something like that. Not saying that they can't play professional football, but to my knowledge at the moment, there are no females that are actually playing professional football. So being told that something is difficult or impossible for you can be sort of like a bug on the windshield if the person actually takes that or resonates, takes that into their heart, or they resonate with it as if it is true for them. What starts happening is that that negative belief starts attracting other similar beliefs, not only in terms of the picture or movie, but also in terms of emotion. Other times when they were told no, maybe you know, they weren't you know they were in high school or something, and they wanted to be picked for a certain team. Whether that is actually something to do with sports, so like, you know, basketball or whatever, or maybe they were broken up into teams to do some type of a project and they didn't get into the team that they actually wanted to get into. Maybe it was some type of rejection that the person experienced or whatever. So some type of painful thing that happened in the past. Sometimes even in this drive, that we're driving as fast as possible in this analogy to try to get from A to Z. Again, Z being the place where we actually want to be in some aspect of our life. Sometimes we even have dirty rear view mirrors so that when we look at the rear view mirror, in this analogy, the rear view mirror is our past. We don't see the things that we actually want to see. What we may see is, you know, disappointing or traumatic experiences. We may actually be resonating with someone else, maybe a relative or a friend that attempted to do something similar to what we are trying to do, and it has given us a we resonated with it, and it's given us the feeling that we either we can't do it, what it is that we want to do, or it will be extremely difficult because we will be going against the same obstacles that the person that we resonated with went through, or maybe that we've gone through in the past before. We are very habitual creatures, and our brain works extremely fast. Our brains want to know actually every single organism in our body, whether that is our body itself, the systems, it's like your digestive system or your nervous system, your lymph system, any system in your body, as well as every single organ, every single tissue, every single cell, in not only in your body, but every single cell, whether that is a one-celled amoeba or that is one particular cell in your body, there are two things and two questions only that those organisms want to learn and want to know. First of all, let me take a step back. Those organisms want to, as physical organisms, we want to do two things, two main things. The first one is to survive. The second thing is to replicate. So survival and replication are the highest things on our physical, for us on our physical body. And that's, without going into too much detail, that's in a way what our ego does. Our ego is really to protect our physical apparatus to help us to survive and replicate. And that's where we get our instincts from, not our intuition, our instincts. So the two things that every cell wants to know in every moment is what is happening and what does it mean? The what is happening is a very objective thing. It's sort of like, when you are viewing something very unemotionally and you, see it pass in front of your eyes and you have no major reaction to it. So the what is happening is very very objective. The subjective thing is what does it mean? The what does it mean, the translation of what it means, actually comes from our subconscious mind, from all of the things we've actually experienced, all the things that we've actually imagined experiencing, all the things we've resonated with, all the things that have actually been passed through to us with other people's emotions and energies and pictures, especially emotionalized pictures or movies that they've actually projected to us in a very telepathic or psychic energy type of way. So the what is happening is very objective. The what does it mean is very, very subjective. So those are the two things that our brains really want to know. So getting back into this analogy of what if you could do whatever it is that your heart's desire is, and this two-sided coin. The first side of the coin is removing the resistance, letting go of whatever are your limitations, especially in terms of beliefs. Letting go of, it's like the person who wants to recover from something that is a challenge health-wise. First of all, they actually have to do things that have let go of the pain, whether that's a physical pain or emotional pain. A lot of times when people go through something physical, they are upset with that physical apparatus part of their body that is actually sort of like letting them down. They actually feel disappointed. They feel upset. They feel hurt. They feel depressed. They feel all these emotions towards some aspect, some part of themselves. And so until that is actually dealt with in a way that makes them feel neutral about that, then they've actually have another layer that they have to go through in order to heal, to actually get to the become as healthy as they would like to be. So the first side of the coin is letting go of the pain. The second side of the coin is doing, I should say, adding in the pleasure. It's like, having stronger desire to get to where it is that you want to go, having those expectations, those beliefs that by doing this or by winning that or by going through some type of a process, even if it's only a mental process, that it is more likely that they will actually achieve that result faster. So the two sides of the coins are, one side is letting go of the limitations and letting go of the resistance, and the second side is moving faster, further, with less effort. So you really need both sides to help us get into, to help us to achieve whatever it is that we want to achieve. So what does this mean, and how does it apply? For example, if someone wants to, we all have things that we would like to accomplish, but we programmed ourselves. I should say we've allowed our circumstances that we have actually helped to co-create. We allow our circumstances to condition our beliefs. What do I mean by that? If you are one of the type of people that said to yourself, when the economy started having quote-unquote trouble, I am going to have trouble too. That belief is something that you picked up somewhere along the line. And if you truly believe that that is true, then it'll actually manifest for you as well. If you're going around and you're hearing all these stories about the people who are having all kinds of financial challenges, which, of course, cause challenges in basically all aspects of their lives, and you pick up those stories and you listen to them and you resonate with them, and then you turn on the television, especially the news, and it's talking about how horrible it is and job losses over here and job cuts over there and all these quote-unquote horrible things. And if you are in an environment where people are feeling and projecting this negative viewpoint with strong emotions, and they have this picture as well as, or a movie going on in their minds, and they are projecting this, or they have this strong emotion while they're actually imagining this picture and or movie, then what happens is, of course, if you pick up that energy, it's like swimming. You know, we're all walking around. Well, it's like this analogy. It's like there's an energetic soup that encompasses every single atom, every single particle, every single photon, every single aspect of every single atom, down to the most minute subatomic particles. Scientists have actually decided to stop giving Nobel Prizes to scientists who keep on finding smaller and smaller particles inside the atom. At one point in time, we thought the atom was the smallest thing in the universe, and it's not it wasn't the smallest. It was only the issue was the atom was the smallest thing that we, with the instruments at the time, could actually find. When the instruments became better and able to find smaller and smaller parts, that's when they found the electron, the photon, and the electron, the neutron, and the proton. And then the instruments got even finer and more able to see smaller particles. And then they found quarks. And then they found particles. And then they found things even smaller than that. And at every stage, when the instruments became better, they were able to find something smaller than what was previously found. And the main scientist that was behind the research and the discovery received the Nobel Prize. But what they're finding is the more the more accurate the instruments get, the smaller and smaller particles that they're able to find. So they stopped giving, they decided to, the Nobel Prize Board decided to stop giving Nobel Prizes in that one area. And I say that to say that we are living in an energetic soup. And the analogy is a baby fish, you know, you could call it a minnow, but anyway, a baby fish going to its mother fish and saying, hey, what is this talk about water that I'm swimming in? You know, people are saying that we swim in water. What is it? And the challenge also is the mother fish trying to explain to the baby fish what water is, even though they are actually living in it and breathing in it and that kind of thing. So what I use that analogy to say that there is a quantum energy that in circulates every single thing, every single atom, all the way down to, it's called the Planck field or the zero-point field, which is the basically what they say where it's literally space, the space not only between the atoms and their parts, but the space between all of the subatomic particles. And in that zero-point field or in that Planck scale, what they have, scientists have agreed, and when I say scientists, beyond nuclear, chemists and nuclear science, these are quantum physicians. What they have found at the zero-point field is energy and information, which literally translates to consciousness. And this consciousness encircles every single atom all the way down to the subatomic particles that we can find and beyond, all the way to the zero-point field and beyond. So I say that to say that we are consciously and unconsciously projecting this energy, and the strongest focuser, or the strongest, the most powerful computer pales in comparison to the ability of one person's focused brain and focusing on something actually directs not only your own energy, but the energy literally of the universe. There's a lot to go into in terms of to explain that, but literally our brains are the most powerful computer in the known universe that can actually focus this energy that is consciousness, that actually encompasses every single atom, every single cell, every single molecule, everything. And by using different energy techniques like the Yuen method, which uses chi energy and the same quantum energy that I was actually describing are synonymous. Chi energy is completely synonymous with this energy, this consciousness, this substance that writers have been talking about for years, and that the same in a lot of Eastern religious practices in India, one of the main religious practices, actually they call this energy prana. In Hebrew, the term is ruha. In Arabic, this term is ruh, which means one translation of it is spirit. But in Taoism and and in some of the Chinese countries, they actually call this, and in Buddhism, they call it qi energy. So this qi energy can be focused and can be directed by using a focused mind and learning a few techniques that assists you in changing as well as directing the qi energy in your body as well as in other people's bodies. And so that's one of the things that we are developing, using the Yuen method as sort of like a guideline to develop the technique that we call the Midas Touch method. And I will have some certification classes on this coming up soon. Once I have everything exactly how I want it and have the teaching materials exactly how I want them, then I will develop the training so that I can help you as well as help the world to have a technique at their fingertips that assists yourself as well as other people in being healthy mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically, psychically, being able to be in alignment with your mind, body, and spirit, being able to quickly recognize the true sources and causes and contributions and combinations of whatever is a limitation for you. Even if it's not in your conscious awareness, it is in your subconscious awareness, and it can be revealed to you so that you can actually remove this as an obstacle. If it seems like a physical obstacle, you can actually still adjust your energy so that the physical obstacle doesn't seem as an obstacle to you anymore. This is a really phenomenal technique, cutting edge, that we want to bring to the world and help to change, help people to use their free will to change their circumstances and to manifest whatever that they want. The greatest gift, in my estimation, other than the correct religion, the greatest gift that you can actually give anyone is mental and physical health. If you had a army at your disposal, if you had as much wealth as John D. Rockefeller had, everything pales in comparison to a person who is actually mentally and physically healthy. Because without your being mentally healthy as well as being physically healthy, you will not be able to truly enjoy what it is that you've actually, whatever huge or abundance of resources you actually have, whether that's a huge family, whether that's some type of having power, whether that's having wealth, whether that's having, an army at your disposal. You truly would not be able to be as happy as you would like to be if you were not physically and mentally healthy. So that is the first part of the show. And I see that you have a few callers. We're about 30 minutes into the show. Again, if you would like to speak or you have a comment, a question, a contribution to the show, please press 1 and I will be alerted that someone would like to communicate with me. If you'd like to listen, that's 100% fine, okay. I do like interaction, like a friend of mine named David called in last week. I've had quite a few exciting and interesting hosts in previous shows as well. So I do see some callers, from a few from the Atlanta area. I don't recognize this other area code here. I see, one caller from Bermuda. And a few other callers here. Sorry, I don't recognize the area code. Looks like someone is actually calling in from Skype. And also, also looks like someone's calling in. I think that area code is actually from Australia. Anyway, again, the phone number is area code 347-838-9279, area code 347-838-9279. Again, I started this show with the question of what if. What if you had a tool at your fingertips that could actually help you to remove resistance and align yourself, both sides of the coin, remove resistance and align yourself so it's much more likely that you can achieve whatever result, whatever manifestation that you actually want to achieve easily and with less effort. What if? Well, it is available. Are you ready for it? We're going to go for a commercial break, and when I return, I will start with the second and third parts of the show.
While we take a 90-second break, please take a moment to visit the website of our sponsors, which is www.peakpotentialpros.com, peakpotentialpros.com, where they show you how you can reach your peak potential in any aspect of your life, as well as where they do training for companies that would like to reach their peak potential as well. So please take a moment to go and visit www.peakpotentialpros.com.
And thank you for listening to the Holistic Healing Show, where we highlight different healing techniques, especially the cutting-edge ones, which include the Emotional Freedom Technique and the Yuen Method, as well as Neuro-Linguistic Programming. Here is the second part of three of the show. What I'm going to talk about on this part of the show, and possibly the next one as well, again, the phone number to call in is area code 347-838-9279, 347-838-9279. What I would like to talk about on this part is self-esteem. What exactly is self-esteem? And when someone says the esteeming self, what exactly is it? Self-esteem is your repetitive concept, I should say repetitive, emotionalized concept of yourself. You know, people talk about generalities in terms of high self-esteem or low self-esteem. The generalities are okay, but here's the thing. Just like when someone says, you know, if you've gone through a trauma or you know someone who's gone through a trauma, and someone tells them, oh, just get over it. Usually the person who says, oh, well, just get over it, doesn't give you tools or techniques to help you get over it. However, at peakpotentialpros.com, we do give you techniques. We do give you tools. We do give you assistance. We do help you get over it, whatever it is. So the same thing is similar, I should say, a similar thing with self-esteem. If someone is described as having low self-esteem, especially when it comes to a particular area of their life, there are, you know, they're usually the person who is describing that someone who's critiquing another person and says that they have low self-esteem, they really don't know exactly how to improve that person's self-esteem, nor do they know the components of self-esteem. So I will give you an insight, or I should say several insights, on exactly what self-esteem is and how to begin the process of changing it. Again, self-esteem, my brief definition of it is your emotionalized opinion of yourself, or I should say repetitive emotionalized opinion of yourself. It is possible to change, make major changes in self-esteem almost like instantly or all of a sudden. It is possible, especially with the techniques, the cutting-edge techniques that we use at peakperformancepros.com. It's a little bit more of a challenge for a person to actually change their own self-esteem, and the main reason for that is because people do not know the components. If you don't know the components, it's like if you're going to go and change your any part of your car, whether that's changing your tire, going to go and change your oil, whatever it is that you want to work on. If you don't know the components and you don't know how they work together, it's very unlikely. Well, first of all, it's very likely that you're going to take a very long time to figure it out. And then the second part of it is that if and when you do figure it out, you may not produce the high quality of workmanship that someone who is actually an expert at, for example, changing a tire or changing your oil can do it. You may miss a few vital points that would make it, and it's in terms of changing your tire, may make you have an accident or may cause some type of physical trouble with your car. Same thing with changing your oil. Your oil may be, even if you do figure out the components, your oil may leak. You may have engine trouble or what have you. So without further ado, let me explain some of the three major components of self-esteem and how you can actually improve them, change them, and manipulate them. So those people who are listening to this call, please grab some paper and a pen. You can hit pause if you'd like, but just grab some paper and a pen because this will be a discussion that not only can vastly improve your life, but the lives of all of those people around you, because with these, with the proper understanding of this one concept, you can make major changes in your life. You see, you cannot outperform your self-esteem for a long time, or for very long, I should say. Your self-esteem is sort of like, imagine an air conditioner. If things get too hot, for example, maybe, things are sort of like too crazy in your life, or things are like, there are too many demands on you. There are too many stressors. You're running at full speed for too long and that kind of thing. When things get too hot, maybe there's too much drama in your life, for example. Maybe you're being too self-critical, critical about yourself. When things are too hot, let's say your air conditioner is set on 70 degrees, and when things get too hot, when they get to, for example, 80 degrees, your air conditioner, meaning your self-esteem, automatically kicks in to actually cool things down so that, you are more consciously able to deal with whatever the scenario or situation is. So a person who is actually being overwhelmed, a lot of times they will start having a health challenge, just like their resistance to colds or flus or whatever will actually be lower because they're more than likely not getting enough rest, but also they are producing so many hormones and so many stress like hormones like cortisol and other things like that, which cause your body to actually break down a bit. And since your resistance is low and your stress hormones are high, it's likely that and some type of an antigen, some type of a virus or bacteria or whatever, can actually gain enough strength in your body to actually cause your body to shut down. And then what do? You actually normally catch a bad cold or a flu, and you are bedridden for a few days while your immune system actually tries to get rid of the virus or the bacteria or whatever you actually quote unquote caught. But that is a way that your self-esteem actually shuts you down so that you can actually then stop being so physically overwhelmed. What if things are actually too calm, too relaxed, too sort of like complacent? You know, it's like, things are, you're laying in bed for too long, or you become a couch potato, or things are like not exciting enough. You know, that's another way of saying that is, someone who feels sad or someone who is normally either has an average or above average happiness in their life, maybe things just start getting too sad. You know, there's too much sadness around them or too much, drama or frustration or whatever. When things get too calm for too long, the heater kicks in, and for example, maybe it gets down to 60 degrees. The heater kicks in and starts pushing it back up to 70. Now, of course, the air conditioner doesn't stop at 70 degrees. It actually starts in terms of going from cold to hot. It actually goes past 70 degrees, and then it shuts off when the thermostat indicates back, the thermostat in the room indicates back to the air conditioning computer system that it has reached the temperature that it is comfortable at, for example, 70 degrees. How does this apply in real life? Let's say, for example, in any area of life, let's say, finances. If someone only used to having, say, $20,000, $30,000 in the bank, and then, something happens let me take a step back. Their bare minimum is having $10,000 in the bank, but they're used to having, $15,000 to $20,000. But the moment that their bank account, for whatever reason, gets below $10,000, they sort of panic, and or they want to do whatever they can to actually raise it back up to $10,000 or more. Another scenario is the gas indicator in your car. If you say to yourself that you're going to commit to always having more than a quarter tank of gas, and whenever you notice that your indicator tells you that you have less than a quarter tank of gas, it means that you are focused on going to the gas station. And when you put your gas in, do you stop at a quarter tank? No, you don't. You normally put in much more gas than a quarter tank, or that stopping point of a quarter tank. So, getting back to the three components of self-esteem, those three components are your self-image, and this is repetitive self-image, your self-worth, or what you think that you are worthy of, and your self-confidence. And self-confidence basically means it actually has two sides of the coin for self-confidence. Self-confidence in general means that the belief that you can handle your day-to-day challenges in life, whether that means that it's your challenges at work, it's your challenges with your own health, your challenges with any of the major components in life, whether that is something financial, something relationship-wise or whatever. So in general, self-confidence means your feeling that you can actually handle your day-to-day and repetitive challenges in life. When I say self-confidence has two sides of the coin, one side of the coin is self-confidence being your ability to go and do something, your willingness and ability to go and do something that is normally a challenge for you. So for public speaking is a challenge for a lot of people. You know, maybe traveling outside a certain area is a challenge for some people. Maybe going and defending yourself or maybe challenging someone that is an authority figure for you, whether that's your boss or a sibling or a parent or someone who is an authority figure for you, and asking them for something that you think that you deserve or that you are worthy of. So that's one side of the coin of self-confidence. The other side of the coin of self-confidence is the feeling that you are in control of your thoughts of you. You have the most control of your thoughts of you, and you do not allow other people's thoughts of you to have, other people's negative thoughts of you to have any real impact on you. So, in other words, you are in control of your own beliefs about yourself. This is the type of person that could care less about what someone says about them, as long as they feel that they're doing the right thing with the, and using the right techniques to get there. They could care less what other people think. This is sort of like the now, everything does have extremes, and I recognize that. You know, one extreme of someone with the first type of self-confidence is, you know, someone who is going around looking for fights and looking for, authority figures to actually challenge, and challenging the police and challenging the judge and challenging everyone that seems like an authority figure to them. And that's an extreme. I'm not promoting that extreme. I'm just saying that the generalities are healthy. There's a healthy amount of self-confidence. And the second part of self-confidence, you know, not caring what other people say, but controlling your thoughts of yourself. You know, there are people that go to an extreme with that as well, that are obnoxious or that are completely nonchalant about others, that kind of thing. I'm not promoting that extreme either. I'm saying there's a healthy amount of both sides of the coin of self-confidence, and that is what I'm promoting. So how does this impact self-esteem? How do those three components, and I hope that you wrote them down, I want you to draw a circle at the top of the page or the middle page and write the word self-esteem. And on the left side, and draw a circle around that. And then below it, on the left side, you'd write the word self-image. Directly below the larger circle of self-esteem, you write the word self-worth, the words self-worth. And to the right side of the big circle that says self-esteem, and to the right of the self-worth circle, you write the word self-confidence. If you want, you can write down the two smaller circles under the self-confidence, and put one would be outward self-confidence, which is, sort of like projected towards the world, like the person that, would go up and, do something that is challenging for them, but it's actually outward. The second part is actually inward self-confidence, and that's the person who has a consistent belief in themselves, and they are not affected by other people's negative opinions of them. Okay? So, change those things. How can we modify them? How can we actually improve our lives, since self-esteem is such a vitally important aspect of our lives? Those are extremely good questions. Again, the area code is 347-838-9279. I can be reached by email, which is peak, P-E-A-K, dot performance, dot P-R-O-F-S, at gmail.com, peak, dot performance, dot P-R-O-F-S, at gmail.com. My website, of course, is www.peakpotentialpros.com, www.peakpotentialpros.com. Facebook, my name is John Holistic Healer, the last name is all one word, John Holistic Healer. I'm also on Skype, Peak Performance Profs, P-R-O-F-S, and those are the major ways to get in touch with me. My site is actually phenomenal now. Now, getting back to the question, how do these three things impact self-esteem? Those things being self-worth, self-image, and self-confidence. How can we change those to actually become the leaders to living the type of lifestyles that we actually want to live? How can we actually have a positive impact on the self-esteem, especially of our children, but of those people around us? How can we encourage and build self-esteem in coworkers, in our workplace, in our everyday lives, in the world? Those are excellent questions, and I will answer those questions after this commercial break.
While we take a 90-second break, please take a moment to visit the website of our sponsors, which is www.peakpotentialpros.com, peakpotentialpros.com, where they show you how you can reach your peak potential in any aspect of your life, as well as where they do training for companies that would like to reach their peak potential as well. So please take a moment to go and visit www.peakpotentialpros.com.
And again, thank you for listening to the Holistic Healing Talk Show, where we highlight, as well as we interview, expert healers who have techniques that give you results. We are a results-centered organization. It's great to have the philosophies. It's great to have the great ideas. It's great to have great processes, but if those processes do not have consistent positive results that are actually long-lasting, then that's where the challenge is. Maybe that's why doctors call themselves practicing medicine as opposed to not only perfecting it or mastering it, but as opposed to truly healing people in their mind, body, and spirit. Maybe not. Getting back to self-esteem. Again, the area code to call in, 347-838-9279, 347-838-9279. I see that I have quite a few people that are listening in. Don't be shy. If you have a question, comment, concern, any type of expression, then please press 1, and I will be alerted that you have a something to contribute to the show, and I will bring you in. First component is self-esteem, which is self-image. How can we change that? Well, there are several ways, but the easiest way to change your self-image is if you want to revert back to an image of yourself where you were, as healthy and happy as you want to, as possible, I should say, maybe one of the healthiest and happiest times of your life. As an adult, it is good to take a picture of yourself back then and put it somewhere whereby it is easy for you to see, and close your eyes and imagine being back in that body and giving yourself self-talk while listening to music. The music can be of your choice. It can be relaxing music, as if you are meditating and you are saying these affirmations. It's even better to record affirmations and play them while you are in this meditation. So you imagine yourself having the physique and having the body that you actually want to have, that you've actually experienced before, and give yourself self-talk as if it's true now. There's something called incantations. Actually, I'll probably do a show on incantations. But you basically give yourself, incantations are stronger than affirmations, because they actually have the same components of affirmations, but the addition is the word now. So you imagine yourself being back in that body. Give yourself as much sensory input as you can with all of your five external senses and five internal senses. And if it's a female, then back then you were a size 6 or a size 8. You imagine touching your body as if you're taking a shower, and you tell yourself, wow, it feels so good to be a size 6 or a size 8 again. I love the way my arms feel, for example. I love the way my waist feels. I love the way that such and such feels. And you give yourself as much sensory input as possible while you're listening to music and or giving yourself affirmations. Okay. Why is that important? Your subconscious does not know the difference between something you are experiencing, something you are imagining that is actually not happening to you, but you are imagining it in great detail with strong emotion, or something you are remembering with strong emotion and sensory input. So by telling yourself that you actually have this physique now, your subconscious reads that as true, and it starts making minor adjustments to actually make that true for you, and it will come to you in the path of least resistance. I have seen and heard stories of people that were trying to lose weight who had strong cravings for desserts and ice cream, and all of a sudden by doing just that one technique, that one process, their self-talk was, wait, I don't enjoy ice cream as much anymore. There's not as much benefit in ice cream for me that there used to be. Why don't I just eat this ice cream later? I don't want to have this now. And by making that one change, not only were they had lower intensity for cravings for ice cream, but they also lost weight and became their ideal figure again, with some other changes as well. So that one technique changes your self-image. If you don't have a picture of yourself, quote-unquote, back then take a picture of someone that you know or someone you don't know in terms of a celebrity or a superstar. And again, it has to be realistic for you. This person should be within 2 inches of your height. And they have to have a physique or some type of health scenario that is similar to yours. Similar to the picture of yourself that you would like to be. For example, I can't imagine myself being Andre the Giant and having his physique. Well, I should say I can imagine myself doing that, but my DNA is not necessarily of the programming to actually give me the genes necessary to actually produce that result. It's not. It's, and plus, subconsciously, I know that that is not a realistic goal for myself. And so I would be short-circuiting the process because, you know, I can't say that I am, you know, Andre the Giant, or I am, you know, I think it was 7'4". I am 7'4", you know, 500 pounds and, you know, a professional wrestler and that kind of thing. You know, that's not realistic in my mind. I could create a scotoma, basically a bipolar scenario or situation if I did do something like that for long enough with strong enough emotion, because since the subconscious does not know the difference between, in this scenario, between something that I'm telling myself am with enough belief and with enough emotion, versus something that I actually am now, it would actually give me, my subconscious would create another identity for me. And either I would have an identity crisis, or I would actually have a split personality if I told myself that I am something that I'm not enough times with enough emotion. So getting back to the directions, find a celebrity or someone that has a physique that you would like to have, but it has to be believable to you that you can have that physique. That person needs to be within 2 inches of your height. And you can imagine being them, but you step into their body and you say this basically the same thing. It feels so great to be, for example, if your ideal weight is 125 pounds, you say, it feels so good that I'm 125 pounds and I wear such and such size. And you imagine yourself, give all the 5 senses that you, if you can. You also imagine other people giving you compliments that, or even echoing back to you that you are 125 pounds. You can imagine standing on a weight scale and it reads 125 pounds. Now, for weight loss, I do suggest that people give themselves a 5-pound range around the weight that they actually want to be. 5 pounds over and 5 pounds under. Why? Because our weights fluctuate daily. And by being too pigeonholed on being in this scenario, 125 pounds, what happens is you feel sort of anxiety if you're 126 pounds. And you feel the reward if you're 124 pounds. And that going back and forth between the two, a lot of times can be emotionally disturbing for someone. So I suggest for people to give themselves a 5-pound range. If that's too wide for you, give yourself a 3-pound range or a 2-pound range. But there must be a range as opposed to a pigeonholed weight that if I'm not at this weight, I'm not happy. So that's the self-image side. Self-worth side, that is developed beginning at a very, very young age, really after we can really understand language, when especially when our parents or whoever is our major source of authority and someone that we are around enough times where we actually believe their opinion of us. So if someone has high self-worth versus low self-worth, self-worth meaning I am worthy of this in my life. I am worthy of this, whether it's a person, place, or thing, whether that's wealth, whether that's poverty, whether that is friendships, whether that is compliments, whatever is in your life. If you feel that you are deserving of it, and the feeling of being worthy of it, very synonymous terms, that is how someone determines what their self-worth is. So when you look around, is your car worthy of you? Is your house worthy of you? Are your clothes worthy of you? In other words, when I say worthy of you, do you deserve better? So how do you adjust that in terms of self-worth? By some of the process, you put on some music, get into a strong emotional positive state, and you start telling yourself over and over again that you are, if you believe in God, and most people do, atheism is actually taking over, but maybe I'll do a show on atheism. Atheism isn't just saying that, you know, someone doesn't believe in God. We all believe in some type of higher power. And if not, then it causes an imbalance in our subconscious mind, because subconsciously we know that there's a higher power. So what you do is you tell yourself while you have this music playing that you are God's child, and you are, and therefore, see, there has to be a why, or answer to the word why. You can say because, or you could say therefore, or some other, what are those called? Not attractions. Those are, I can't remember the term in English. Terms like however, therefore, but contractions, not contractions. But anyway, you tell yourself that you are worthy of the best because you are God's child, or you are God's child, therefore you are entitled to, or therefore you are worthy of, or therefore you deserve, or therefore you know, you can receive, and therefore you can experience, therefore you can enjoy, therefore, you see, you tell yourself over and over these things while you're actually in a high, positive, strong state, and imagining being surrounded by all of these things, whether it's wealth, whether it's great friends, great relationships, a better house, car, whatever, better job. So you tell yourself over and over again, but you have to be in a positive state first. So that is the self-worth kind of how to adjust it. Self-confidence. Self-confidence, you can, how does self-confidence impact you? Well, if you fear some type of rejection, and that could be, you know, you bought a damaged item from Walmart and you want to go back to Walmart to exchange it for something or get a refund. If you feel as if this is going to be a great challenge for you in terms of dealing with the person behind the desk and basically arguing your point and asking for the refund, or could be a salesperson that's knocking door to door trying to sell something, but they don't feel they see, strength always wins. And if someone believes that they don't have that, you know, the next door that they knock on, the person will be stronger than they are, stronger with their no than the salesperson is with their convincing, then they would be likely to not give all their resources, all their mental and physical resources, get them focused towards the result they want, which is making the sale. There's a lot of other scenarios, you know, the self-confidence of going and talking to an authority figure and asking them, or possibly even on the extreme side, demanding some type of correct treatment or the raise or the promotion. It could be the feeling of speaking your truth. This is sort of like the other side of confidence, self-confidence. speaking your truth to yourself, telling yourself that, maybe you have something physically that you would like to improve with your body, but it's not just not happening. Maybe you are balding. Maybe you are, some type of wound or some type of scar or whatever, and you feel insecure. Again, insecurity can be described as one opposite of self-confidence. So how do you change that? Good question. I will answer that after the next commercial break. And again, the phone number is area code 347-838-9279, peakperformancepros.com, and you can email me at peak.performance.prfs@gmail.com, peak.performance.profs@gmail.com. Again, I'm your host, John Fletcher. You can find me on Facebook, too, using John Holistic Healer, and I will answer the question of self-confidence when I return from this break.
While we take a 90-second break, please take a moment to visit the website of our sponsors, which is www.peakpotentialpros.com, peakpotentialpros.com, where they show you how you can reach your peak potential in any aspect of your life, as well as where they do training for companies that would like to reach their peak potential as well. So please take a moment to go and visit www.peakpotentialpros.com.
Again, the phone number is area code 347-838-9279. We broadcast a show every Thursday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can also visit my site, which is www.peakpotentialpros.com, where we teach you how to reach your peak potential, remove the bugs from your windshield, let go of the brake, and go full throttle forward, moving faster, further, with less effort, using our cutting-edge techniques to help you get there, arrive safely and enjoyably in less time and with less effort than basically anywhere else, anything else around. I am the founder, John Fletcher. I can be found on Facebook by looking up John Holistic Healer, as well as Skype, Peak, P-A-K, Performance, Profs, P-R-O-F-S, and I've also given you my email address. Now, getting back to self-confidence and the two parts of self-confidence, the two sides of the coin, the outward side, which means that you are generally a person that is trying to overcome some type of challenge outward on the outside of them, whether that is going and fighting that lion, going and standing up for themselves to, some type of authority figure, going and doing something that's difficult, like public speaking and making themselves open and available. That could also be in a relationship, allowing themselves to be open and available to their partner or to their spouse. That takes a certain level of self-confidence as well. So, and then there's an inward aspect, the other side of the coin, which is being so certain, being so committed to your opinion of yourself that it doesn't really matter what other people's negative opinions of you are. You're so committed to yourself and that the process or procedure that you use on a day-to-day basis is the correct one for you. It fits you, and you are and you enjoy it, that it really doesn't matter what other people say, believe, or do. You are committed to your point of view, so you care less what other people do. That can, you know, again, these things do have extremes. So how can we change our self-confidence, which is the third part of self-esteem? This is how you do it. What you do is, again, sensory input. You play music that inspires you. That could be something like one of the things that I used to listen to. Again, I'm in my early 40s. There was a movie that people in my generation really resonated with, which was called Rocky. And it was, of course, there were five Rockies, but the very first one had an incredible instrumental track. Sylvester Stallone actually won an Oscar for it. It was his first time being a screenwriter. I think he may have won two Oscars, but I know he won one Oscar. The musical score on it actually won quite a few awards as well. So one of the songs on there is the Rocky theme when he's actually running up this huge, this long set of stairs which were outside, and when he gets to the top, he's jumping up and down, and there were some scenes leading up to it as well, as far as like a crowd getting bigger and bigger, running along with him and encouraging him, and basically you know, cheering him and that kind of thing. So he gets to the top of this set of stairs, and the crowd is going wild, but he's jumping up and down, and the musical score is sort of like da 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 while he's running da da da, and the chorus behind him is saying, you know, getting stronger, and so to the point at the crescendo, at the very peak of the song, the very peak of the emotion, when he reaches the top of this the end of his jogging, but at the top of this set of stairs, these steps, I should say, that are outside, it's at the very peak of everything, and he's jumping up and down, full of energy, full of life, full of everything. So that song I used to listen to when I used to jog, at the time when I was in college, running 5 miles was a challenge for me. And so I would play that song as well as other songs. But that song, because it had a strong emotional content for me, because I had this mental movie I had this mental movie of Rocky, and I sort of like first of all, I resonated with Rocky. Of course, played by Sylvester Stallone. I resonated with him, and I can imagine myself achieving some goal, jumping up and down with full energy, full life, with the crowd going wild, and you know, support the positive projections of people. In other words, people cheering for me, and I'm jumping up and down at the peak of the music, at the peak of the emotion, at the peak of everything. So find something that resonates with you for that strong, positive, accomplishing emotion. Play that, and then imagine yourself doing something that, after you actually get to a strong emotion, however, after you get to that strong emotion, then imagine yourself taking whatever physical steps that it actually, that you believe that it takes you to accomplish whatever this is, and imagine yourself not only accomplishing it, but getting feedback as if it has been accomplished, and feel it over and over again. You play this song as many times as necessary, so that whenever you close your eyes, you can see yourself doing the, taking the steps that it takes to accomplish this goal, accomplishing it, and then also getting feedback that you have actually accomplished this goal. This is one of the most powerful steps that anyone could actually take to give themselves more confidence in any area. If you have approach avoidance to anything, whether that is approach avoidance means that you actually want, part of you wants to do something, but part of you fears some type of pain with doing it, so you want to approach it, but you avoid it, that's called approach avoidance. It could be with doing some type of a chore. It could be doing it could be something work related. It could be about something as far as like making a phone call that you know that you should make but you haven't made it. Those kind of things. Those are called approach avoidance things. You know, knowing that you should do something but not actually taking the actions, whether that's a one-time action or a consistent action towards doing it. So if someone is actually having a weight challenge in terms of like, getting started with an exercise program, they can see themselves at the gym. And so in their mental movie, they are playing the song. They're actually seeing themselves at the gym, enjoying the gym, you know, and maybe a crowd around them cheering them on while they're actually doing something that's difficult or a challenge for them. And they do it over and over until they actually feel whatever they think about doing, whatever the action is, they feel this positive, encouraging, motivating feeling. So when you do all three of these things together, it can be in one movie or it could be in three different parts. The exercise I gave you about how to change your self-image or improve your self-image. The exercise I gave you about changing your self-worth and by saying that, you know, you are worthy of such and such because you are God's child, or if it is something to do with your self-confidence. If you change any one of these things, it would have a strong impact. If you change two of them by doing the exercises, it has a magnifying effect and a multiplying effect. But if you did all three, you would have exponential changes in whatever it is that you actually want to change in your life. And since every aspect of our lives or every major aspect of our lives actually does have other parts of our lives attached to it, you will vicariously, without even exerting any physical effort, you'll actually change other aspects of your life too. What do I mean? If you are motivating yourself to go and ask your boss for a raise, for example, and you've done all three exercises. I'm going to getting into my last 6 minutes, so I don't want to go back into detail. So if you're doing, if you go through the exercises and you finally become confident enough to go and approach your boss for a raise and you receive it, not only can that change your financial present and your financial future, but it changes health-wise too, because maybe you wanted to have additional income so that you can actually eat more organic food, or you wanted to take a vacation and take, you know, your family with you or whatever, or you wanted to change, you know, you wanted to have another car, or a newer car, or make repairs to your car. So, you know, that something that resonates with your new feeling of self-worth. Maybe you wanted to go. Anyway, the impacts of having more wealth in this scenario has an impact on all basically every aspect of your life, mentally, physically, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically, psychically / empathetically. You know, you go through, you know, if you change something, some aspect of yourself, let's say your weight, wouldn't that have, and you're more likely to, and what was, for example, maybe what was stopping you was, you know, not following through with your exercise program, but now you've gone through these exercises and now being consistent with your exercise program is no problem for you. Wouldn't that also change your outlook on life, your self-esteem in general, but change your self-image, change your self-worth, change your self-confidence? You know, whatever area of your life that you actually want to improve in, you can actually use these techniques and you can change any aspect of your life. Sometimes it could happen instantaneously. Sometimes it does take a little more time for you to align, for other aspects of your life to actually align with this one major change that you've actually made, so that you can be congruent and everything can be, like I said, in alignment and fit in properly, and therefore you'll be able to sustain that change for much longer. So that is how you can actually improve your self-esteem. So the next time you actually hear someone say or make a comment that so-and-so has low self-esteem, or the next time you are told that you have low self-esteem, now you know how to repair it. Are you brave enough to actually try these techniques? Try them now so that you actually have some experience with them, so that whenever you do want to change something major in your life, you actually can easily change it rather than going back to listening to this and then trying to gather enough momentum. So try it now. Don't wait. It's better to have the techniques and not need them than to need the techniques and not have them. This is our show for the day. We have 2 minutes left. And again, I am the founder of peakpotentialpros.com. This is like scratching the very surface of the very surface of what cutting-edge techniques and tools that we have at peakpotentialpros.com. If you have not visited recently, go and take a look, because we have modified the site. It is phenomenal and even more phenomenal now, and it actually helps to boost my self-esteem. Again, I'm your host, John Fletcher, and thank you for listening. And thank you for listening to the Holistic Healing Using Energy Modalities, the Yuen Method, EFT, and NLP talk show. And also, we talk about the Law of Attraction. Again, I'm your host, and we have a show for you every Wednesday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. Please spread the word and tell your friends, and feel free to download this show for your future reference and to share with others. You can find us on Facebook at my name, which is John, last name, Holistic Healer, John Holistic Healer, or by email address, peak.performance.profs@gmail.com, peak.performance.profs@gmail.com. Thank you for listening, and I look forward to your participation next
Thursday at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time.